All right, so I'm Matt. So not a robot, that is the name of the company. And basically between what we put inside the human body as being a very artificial thing versus what the actual body is in and of itself and what it needs. So what I'd like to talk to you about is really more of a design exploration and less instructional, because I think a lot of the current algorithms, some of you guys have heard about, a lot of software companies doing a lot of really cool things. And this isn't really intended to be, again, like a roadmap to getting to a final solution, but really more of an exploration on how can we learn from the way that biology works and maps itself, and is it applicable to what we're currently doing? What are the things we can learn? So a little bit of an agenda, a little about me, lesson of the trees. I'm obsessed with trees at the moment. And then we're going to talk about bone, which I'm very familiar with. Both of these are we're just going to look at the structure. We're going to take some time to figure out, like, how does computational design play with the structures? Can we mimic them? How do we do that? No questions, though. Dwan doesn't want to do any questions. So quick, who am I? What do I do? Just computational design, med devices. That's all you need to know. Look at my LinkedIn. I post way too often. So I want to talk a little bit about engineered versus biological structures. Because when we talk about biology and nature, there's this iterative loop. That's what I'm going to keep coming back to. This is the idea that biology is ever-changing. It's evolutionary. It never stays in stasis because it responds to external feedback conditions. So when we looked at engineering structural, you have an initial problem, right? That's basically what people pay me to do now, right? I've got a problem. Here's my bounding conditions. Solve this thing for me. So we may do some simulation optimization. There may be algorithms associated with it. There's simulation, there's design parameterization. Maybe you're using machine learning or statistics, things like that. There's this refinement section where you basically say, all right, I'm gonna further refine this based upon the results that I get out of my analysis. And then you sort of do a final validation to confirm, like, yep, I solved your problem. Here's the solution. But here's what I actually think is interesting is it's not really a loop, and that the loop is confined to this refinement, because once you produce the final thing, an additive, it is a first order static solution. Very rarely, like you heard from the speaker before me, which was an awesome presentation, does it biologically respond to whatever its environmental conditions are. It's static. I mean, we print in metal, we print in plastic, those things don't change. They're stuck that way. And I see so many people that are like getting this inspiration from biology, and then they print in titanium. And it's like, well, cool. It looks organic, but the whole reason why bone is bone and is shaped like bone is because it's vascularized. It has blood flow, it can change, it breaks, it repairs itself. So when we look again at a biological structure, it exists, its sole purpose is to exist in an equilibrium state, right? Stasis. So that it's in harmony with its current surroundings. And like a tree that is blown by the wind or in storms, it continually adapts to its surroundings. So it's seeing a force, and it's adapting to that by saying, hey, I see a force and I am no longer in harmony anymore. It changes its structure, so its harmony gets disrupted. It evolves its structure. So we talk about like long-term evolution, but there's an evolutionary process that happens in each of our bodies every second, and that's just the body's adaptation to your local surroundings. And then the structure itself sort of enforces and trims, so enforces in areas where it sees some sort of a loading, and it gets rid of the things that it doesn't actually need. And then again, feedback. It puts itself back in harmony, and then it's in a happy spot. So what biological systems produce is an nth order dynamic solution capable of change, which, again, I'm so very happy that Natalie was right before me, because she's investigating these biological feedback mechanisms, right? And that's fundamental, in my opinion, for the future of computational design as we consider biological printing and things of that nature. So let's talk a little bit about my current obsession. That's trees. So this is an old, I'm going back to, 19th century graphics here. You may bend the sapling, but not the tree. I actually started getting obsessed with this because we started a tradition where the kids every single weekend want to get up and do a fire in the morning. So I've got my oldest son, he's almost 7, and he can like start a fire by himself now. I'm just like, let him. I'll get out in the morning and there's like a fire, really can't get him apart. If you like green branch that's got some moisture in it, like you can't bend it. And so I was like, I'm not sure. So I started to do a little bit of investigation on like why saplings or green wood are so incredibly resilient to breaking in general. And so again, this is something that's been used from a cultural significance standpoint, but in the Ozark Mountains, there's a lot of these sort of tree markers for pointing to specific locations or trails. And basically when trees are saplings, they're shaped to a specific shape. And then as they grow, they retain the characteristics of essentially what their environment is. They're forced into a box and they adapt themselves to their surrounding. So the internal structure of them allows for significant strain, well past the point of what would be considered normal in a engineering structural problem, while maintaining the cellular connections, being totally vascularized, and growing that way, essentially into a full structure where they finally solidify. So again, just like incredibly cool to look at the microstructure. And when we start talking about the softwares now, well, number one, the processes are capable of creating incredible geometry. And now we have software that's capable of actually taking advantage of the geometry that we can create and create these incredible hierarchical structures, right? You know, the human skin, right? That's a hierarchical structure from what we see at the macro scale all the way down to the cellular level in multiple orders of magnitude, right? So at the microscopic level, wood is highly vascularized, contains long-oriented strands, if you look at the radial sort of section cut, as well as tangential. So you've got these sort of oriented fibers that maintain this really great flexibility, while also can resist torsion and allow for the bending. So again, what I do is I'm just like, I look at something that like looks really cool, and I'm like, can we model this? And what would be the point in that? And modeling the system in a way that's available for somebody to use, like in a bracket or in an implant or something like that. So there's two different things, and we'll look at the kind of the solution in the middle, right, the left, and then the solution on the right, and what the difference is between the two. So I'm going to do something that no one ever recommends, and I'm going to model live. I've never been bitten by it before. Tempting fate. All right, so here's the thing. We got set of boundary conditions. We're interested in understanding how the load sort of interacts with the structure and what the structure does. So here we just, you know, simple push force. We've got one structure here. The thing on the left is actually a more common algorithm. And it basically says, optimize my structure, essentially keeping all the load conditions under whatever my thresholds are. But what's interesting is you'll notice something really cool is on the right. And this is an algorithm that I think people need to do a little bit more exploring. And essentially says, in response to this particular loading condition, what's the geometry that allows me to maximize displacement in that way, right? So we're, you know, when you talk about geometrical compliance from an engineering standpoint is, let me sort of hold the load with as limited geometry as possible, but I'm really more interested in the reverse. What allows me to maintain hyper flexibility in a certain geometry? Because I deal a lot with metal, right? How do you make metal flexible? What sort of structures do you need to create? So if we've got another problem, right? We're going to hold it in the middle, and we're going to smash both ends. I like saying smash. I don't know why. Smash instead of squash. And so the technicalities of the workflow are less important because, again, this is not necessarily the time for that. But what's actually really cool is I'm partially dumb, but I'm not that dumb. So I didn't include the iterative loop towards convergent. This is artificially looped only six times to get to a false convergence, because I thought like if I was going to do that live, that would be really dumb. So what's interesting, look at the one on this middle one versus the one on the right. This is a case where like we're holding in the middle and we're wanting to squish both ends. You'll notice that the structures here are oriented specifically to resist, right? It's columnar structures, whereas these have this sort of sandwich shape, and that maximizes displacement in that location, which again, from an engineering standpoint, you say, well, you know, I have got this load case and I want to be able to withstand whatever my maximum, but we query completely different things. We're not really querying strains or stresses as much because it's going to self-repair. Again, an entirely different way of looking at it from an engineering problem, which is just I'm designing a single static structure that has to last for hundreds of years. So then we can go to a separate problem, one we'll show this real quick. So we've got this common algorithm, structural compliance, And then we've got biological algorithm, where you take structure out and you just say compliance. I need it to move. I want it to move. It needs to be able to interact with its surroundings in a way that's meaningful. And again, this is something that, again, I'm very familiar with in bones. So biological scaffolding. And most of the time people, like, it's really cool seeing what generative algorithms are doing. I move past the point of where I think like functional grading, like thickening or cell size is cool, to the point of like morphological grading, because I think that it provides a far more sort of complex interactive way of how we deal with the geometry, especially when looking at biological systems, which almost always are morphologically graded to their surroundings. So quick background if you don't know, but basically in the 19th century, this guy said, hey, bones are adapting to their surroundings in a way. Harold Frost came in the 1960s and defined it in this Frost-Mechanistat theorem, which is shown here, which is basically like this loading zone, which is the homeostasis, has a disuse where elements are trimmed or removed, and an overload where we get key growth, and then a pathological overload, which basically says I'm being stimulated too much, and it doesn't create the right bone formation. So you've got this perfect strain rate where you get this really cool sort of modeling scenario. What's interesting when people, like when you actually go and look at the structure of like a biologic scaffold, you actually get like weird stuff, disconnected elements. Things don't necessarily make sense all the time. Again, from an engineering standpoint, you're thinking, I need to maximize like the material that I have, my weight savings, and I need like this to withstand a load and only use this much material. But biology kind of is like, whatever, I don't care about that. It's a different way of dealing with it, which again, then from an engineering standpoint, it's like, I need to solve this problem. So we don't really think of that. The disconnected elements don't matter biologically because there's a chemical reaction, which basically says this, you're not getting used anymore. And it starts basically resorbing the bone back into the body and using the minerals for something else to get back to homeostasis. So you've got a maintenance, a reinforce, and then a remove that's part of this biological homeostasis. So actually, this is when I started thinking about, you know, what if an algorithm sort of did the same thing? And NTOP actually gave this whole, like this field optimization, and other people are starting to get this idea of like thresholding out the things that don't need to be there, right? It's topology optimization plus using it with an algorithm. But I will say, I'm going to show another thing. I was doing field optimization before field optimization was field optimization. So the idea behind this is sort of an evolutionary algorithm. And it's this idea that we don't ever just look at a single time-dependent step, but we look at a transient sort of flow from loading and understand, like, if this did get implanted in the body, what exactly is this going to see over time? So specifically for like resorbable materials, less so is it like, this is a titanium scaffold, but really what we're interested in is something that's going to be ingested by the body over time, and how is the part potentially going to change its shape? So we've got this sort of time-dependent evolution. You can do stresses, strains, displacements, however you want to input the sort of the problem statement of what's going to happen with this thing, obviously simplified from a geometry standpoint. And what you'll notice is, like, if the algorithm is biological versus what you would consider structural, you get elements that don't necessarily make engineering sense, right? They're disconnected. They still follow some sort of structural compliance problem, but they don't necessarily act in a manner which humans would say, I need just these trusses to connect the shape from top to bottom to get where I'm going. And I think that's, again, what I've been particularly fascinated by, because it's less so a problem of, again, current algorithms sort of want to converge on a solution. But when you look at like it biologically, there's not really any convergence, because by the time it gets to the point where it's stable, there's already other influences acting on it, and it just needs to change again. So when we look at load response, now we're looking at something that's more like strain response. So again, if you look at it from an algorithmic standpoint and you look at each time dependent step, sometimes it makes sense and sometimes it doesn't. So when you just talk again about what something should be doing versus what it actually is doing, sometimes things make sense. So basically in this case, we're like tipping it over from the top. We're going to push it. And you can look at the algorithm itself and you can actually sort of be like, all right, I can understand it, why this is forming to a certain extent. Again, we're prioritizing displacement. We're not prioritizing sort of structural compliance in the way that most engineers define it. But if you look at a more complicated thing where we kind of have multiple constraints. Again, because I'm doing it live, I'm not dumb. So I'm only I'm only going so far. And so we sort of have a little bit more of a load case where, you know, we've got the sharp geometry at the corners and we're kind of pushing and pulling in a certain way. What the solution that manifests, where we start thresholding out elements and sort of trimming things to shape, you start getting missing pieces. And again, from a pure engineering standpoint, and again, I'm an engineer and I know all the like right rules for engineering, but what I've always been fascinated by, again, is these sort of systems, biological printing materials that resorb and that grow and that change over time, I think are only going to continue to be more important. The end keynote yesterday was another sort of fascinating example of utilizing local materials, local manufacturing processes to create something that's just, you know, very ingrained with sort of nature, right? This ecology, the sustainability factor. And similarly, again, with the body, my entire the last 15 years have been spent talking about creating biologically relevant implants. Biologically relevant means the best implant is one that the body doesn't know exists or that it forgets it exists. So when we start talking about resorbable materials and printing with bone itself into a scaffold that's resorbable, you can't make the traditional assumptions that you used to make, which is I got to take this amount of stiffness for X amount of time, and it becomes a more multifaceted problem. So again, when we step through this slowly, there's my timer, right on time. When we step through this a little bit slowly, you can see sort of the evolution of the algorithm, again, exists solely in these sort of time-dependent states as and not interconnected. In other words, sometimes elements go away and it was the next step and it doesn't make as much sense to you from a human standpoint, but it's just the evolution of what the algorithm sees and how it responds to the conditions that it's been given over time. So, I mean, that's basically it. You know, I really appreciated the opportunity to be able to chat. Thanks to Juan so much, and hope to see you guys around.